Today, our presentation, I would like to show you how to make Python great again. How to interact with Python code, C or C++ code easy and in efficient way. When it important, but it useful. What was the problem? Suppose we have a large amount of input data, a couple, I don't know, gigabytes, 10 gigabytes of input data, and or we need to process that data by some algorithm that may be run in concurrent mode, multi-threading mode. And it's a kind of number crunching task. Nothing special, but Python isn't probably optimal language for number crunching tasks. Okay, well, we have that data, that algorithm, and we would like to process it in Python. We write our perfect code, of course, run it, and surprisingly, we faced with typical limitation of all Python. It's a global interpreter lock. And now we need to understand how to solve that problem. A possible way it's a cry, just because some people convinced that tears may solve any problem. You may try to cry, but it's probably not our way. Another possible solution is by using third-party libraries like NumPy, SciPy, etc. A lot of them. Alternative way it's by using Cython. It's some dialect of Python with a kind of different name. I'll take more bit that slightly later. And of course, you may write your own binary extension in your preferable language like C or C++ and connect it with Python code in some way. How? Let me explain later. Now, a couple of words about NumPy. NumPy it's a library written as a part of SciPy project. Documentation. It's well documented project, widely spread project. You may use it in context of our task. NumPy and SciPy has more or less the same benefits, the same limitations, and we may take one of them and demonstrate pros and cons of each of them. First, start from advantages. First advantage of NumPy, it's optimized code. Really optimized because it's a popular project and it's also well-tested code. Because it's not new one, it's something which famous for the years, and it's well documented also, as I said. It provides a huge number of predefined functionality, predefined function modules. You may use any of that. And yes, it's a code that is written in C++ with all benefits of that. But Disadvantages of using NumPy, it's that NumPy is, as well as SciPy, is optimized by numbers only. Yes, you may put any Python object into NumPy array, but it wouldn't be as efficient as numbers. NumPy and SciPy are optimized for numbers, only for numbers. If you have anything beside that, sorry. Yes, NumPy provides a giant number of functionality, numbers of functions, but that numbers is fixed. If you want something unusual, sorry, it's your pain. Well, if you don't want or cannot use NumPy or any third-party libraries, you may write your own code by using Cython. What is Cython? Cython is Python on steroids. And it's from official documentation. It's optimizing static compiler for both Python programming language and extend. And in fact, something like C or C++ code. And it also may be used as a kind of middleware between your Python code and C++ code or C++ binary modules that are written in C++ or C. In general, between any binary modules. But if you want, you may write your code only in Cython by using multi-threading, real multi-threading, static typing, and so on and so forth. It's up to you. Let's talk a bit more about task, about problem, which we may face. For instance, suppose we have a large set of points on some space. It might be anything, three-dimensional space, two-dimensional, 100 million dimensional space. It doesn't matter. But to be simple, let's take a simple surface. It might be Euclidean space or any other space, like surface of Earth. Anything else, but suppose you have a point with two coordinates, and you have giant sequence of that point, and you would like for each point to find all neighbors. Neighbors, it's points that are within some distance, like distance. It's a regular Euclidean distance that may be computed by this formula. It's nothing special, but problem here is that it should be computed between each point should be check anything else to ensure that this is within limit or without. It's because in input we have unsorted sequence of point. If you like, you have a set, a typical Python set, a set of point that are unsorted, and you cannot sort it because of some limitation caused by business logic. And you would like to, in that conditionals, you would like to check each point if it's within your limit or outside that. Yes, it's a typical KNN problem, KNN's neighbor problem, and it's a problem solved in SciPy that provides a bunch of function. You may check it here with different algorithms with different complexity and so on and so forth. And yes, what was said above, it's a naive brute force implementation that has probably the worst, one of the worst complexity O square n. But in some cases, it's one way that you have. For instance, I had faced in one project with similar task. It's a kind of polygons with now a bunch of vertices, and I had to check neighbors between polygons. There were some limitation from business side caused by business logic. What is neighbors? Like polygons shouldn't overlap. Two polygons should have at least two vertices in common to be considered as neighbors, and so on and so forth. So in a case like that, you cannot use trivial solution. You cannot use third-party libraries like NumPy, like anything else, especially if there are no solution that is suitable for your problem. Another pain that it's a memory. Suppose just suppose that we try to implement a solution of our problem by brute force. We have a NumPy array with 100 million points. It's average number for that task, and we would like to find neighbors for each point. Default type of and of course, because it's a coordinates, it's each number is it's a float, and we need to use double in time of C++ or a float 64 because of accuracy of coordinates. It's also important in some cases. And default type of float numbers in NumPy is float 64, which means that we have 64 bits per point. After some computations, we see that our 100 million points each has two numbers because of coordinates on surface. That 100 million points requires 1.5 gigabytes of memory. It's a memory only for raw input data, without anything, any wrappers, Python code, additional data, and so on and so forth. It's only raw data in optimized way, because NumPy is more or less optimized in from memory point of view that you have to process. Once you try to process it by using brute force, it means that we need to multiply two vectors by using a vector multiplying. As a result, we will get a two-dimensional tensor, which contains approximately 2.25 gigabytes data. Once we try to process. One more note about that. It's a 2.25 for temporary data, in fact, because it's a 2.25, it's for result of searching neighbors plus input data plus something else that we need to process. It's a really significant memory requirement, I'd say. Once we have five times more data, half of billion, brute force means that only for result we need approximately 56 gigabytes data. I'd say it's slightly too much for regular developer workstation, for regular PC or laptop, and it's too much for that task. It would be nice if we just take our input data, like 7.5 gigabytes, and process it as is. For instance, with some additional memory, like maybe plus 50% of additional memory, it would be great. But we cannot use NumPy for that purpose. Just because NumPy, it's something that works with matrices, with vectors, and you cannot doesn't provide you a convenient way for processing each point, each item separately. Yes, you may use vectorize, but to like something like map, but it's for convenience, not for performance. And you cannot just use brute force and NumPy to solve something like that. It means that you need to write your own code. In C++, for instance, in C or something else, like Cython, you may write your own Cython code. In fact, Cython, it's you may write your own code like Python, but your Cython code should have PyX suffix, PyX extension in file name, like underscore knn.pyx. As I said, you may write regular Python code inside Cython files like this one, and it will be compiled into C extension and import as usual. But it looks strange why you use Cython to write regular Python code. It's possible, of course, but it doesn't provide you any benefits. You may write something like that. There are structure of that code, that module, is similar to your regular Python code, with couple differences. First of all, please pay attention at the import section. Here you may see regular import, like import numpy as np. It's identical to your Python code, but beside that you see C import. It means that you say Cython that you want to import a C extension, something from compiled code that will be used as a C extension. It's not a regular Python code. It's something else. It's one thing that's specific for Cython, and it's really efficient. Next two lines, C-type dev, it's some alias. You define alias, that short name for something long type. It's possible if you want to save some space, some numbers, or it looks more convenient for you. Next, a few decorators. So you may write it, you may skip it, it's up to you. But in this case, you say Cython that it should generate code without additional checks, without checking boundaries, without wrappers, without checking division by zero, and so on and so forth. Please check official documentation of Cython to understand what you can use and what which decorator means. Next, it's a bit typo here, but anyway, we'll see that later. Correct way. CPDEF should be before return type. I'll show it a bit later. But let me check it. Maybe right here. Yeah, like this. Okay, and yeah, about CPDEF. You may write just def to define your function. You may write CDEF. You may write CPDEF. Difference here is next. Def, it's just typical Python code, and with all benefits and limitation of that. It might be imported from Cython, from binary module. And it might be used mainly by Python code. It's supposed to be used only from Python code. CPDEF, it's something between C code and Python code. It might be used by as well as C code and or Python code. It's supposed to be used in any way. And CDEF means that it's used only by C code, and that cannot be imported directly from Python or into Python. But you write your typical function, you put CPDEF or CDEF if you want, you write expected result, you define type of each input data. You may skip that definition, it's okay, it works, but once you define type, it allows Cython to produce more efficient, more strict code. Yes, typed code, a static typed code, it's kind of unusual in Python, but it's convenient. It provides too much benefits to avoid it. Yeah, and if you need something more, if a Cython isn't enough, you may use C++ code. Suppose you you have our task that we talked earlier may be solved by using only site encode with some limitation and something else, but suppose we need or we would like to use C++ code. Assume we have a function like that is written in C++. It's a simple function that accepts two dimensional vector of double number of threads and returns vectors of unsigned long. Just something like that. And in Cython, you may use this. You may use function from C++ by a description. It you what you you need it just describe it by this structure. It's for anything that you import from binary code that you would like to include into your code, to link to your code. You write cdef extend from h file, no gl. It's obvious that you don't want to use global interpreted lock inside that. In otherwise, you say that this function doesn't use global interpreter lock, and then you, in fact, you just describe signature of that function in by using some Cython syntaxes, which is pretty similar to C++ or C, if you prefer C. And then, then you just use it. And as I said earlier, cdef, just pay attention at cdef, it allows you to define functions, variables, class has a bit different syntax, but nevertheless, you define your own function. Input data, it's a NumPy array. Remember, we have a large NumPy array with 100 millions of points, two-dimensional, as it's you may see it in signature of KNN function, and we would like to convert it into a vector, C++ vector, so a typical structure from C++. And you describe, it's a possible way to describe your data. It's converts. It's one way to convert data from one format into another, from NumPy array to vectors. And also pay attention at the structure, at sign before data. It means that you we will pass our data inside C++ code by reference, not by copy, and that's why we need to convert data into vector before taking address of it, because data it's still a Python object and we need a C++ object to pass it into C++ code. And by using this trick to converting casting types, we in next line we may easily pass data into a vector, into our C++ code. And C++ code returns also vector that we may convert into NumPy array. We may just wrote something like NumPy np dot as array result, and that's all. But it copies data, and we would like to avoid redundant copy. That's why we using memory view. It's a trick from Cython that allows us to, in fact, it passes pointer to the internal structure of vector inside NumPy array, and NumPy array wraps its own structures around that pointer, that piece of memory, by using this trick. You may check it, read a bit more about that by links, by next links. It's official documentation of Cython. Nothing special here. If you want, you may Google it just by something like a pass NumPy array, pass vector from into NumPy array or something like that. By anyway, it's nothing special. It's official trick, official hack if you want. Okay. Yeah. If you want to return list, just define your function as something that return list, and just return vector as is. Cython will convert it implicitly vector into a Python list before returning. Just up to you. Well, and you may import it easily, just as a regular Python function. Why init.py is because as you see, Cython function is static type. It requires some specific types. It has some limitations that important before passing data, and it's convenient to write some wrapper in your init.py function that will checks if all conditionals are met, if everything is okay. Because otherwise you may get, instead of result, you may get segmentation fault. You may get pointer error exception. You may get any surprises that are typical for C or C++ code. Okay. That's great. And we have a question how to compile. Okay, we wrote our Cython code, we wrote our C++ code, but how to compile that? It's obvious, it's trivial, but we have to use setup.py. Yeah, but before we be able to do anything else, we have to install some additional packages. First of all, we need a Python dev package, or in case of Python 3, it's Python 3 point any version which you use, like Python 3.6 dev, Python 3.8 dev, and etc. And in addition, we need to install Cython and NumPy. It's before compile that. Just because Cython setup.py uses inside itself Cython, imports Cython, libraries from Cython and NumPy, and it's clear that we need to have those packages installed before import anything from it. And then once we have that, once we have setup.py written, we just say setup.py build X in place. In place, it's for for development purposes, for testing purposes. If you install that, you just say pip install package and it builds, compiles extension, put it in right place. And it's automatic. You don't need to say anything else. Just say pip install what you need. But for developing purpose, for testing purpose, you're supposed to use this one. Build X in place. That's all. It builds, it compiles your C extensions, it put it in properly places, what you defines. A couple moments later, I'll explain you how to describe properly place. And you will be able to work with that for next steps. It's a code, some part of code in from setup.py. You need some functions, some structure from setup tools, and as I said, from Cython. Find packages if you ever written setup.py. You know that find packages, it's important thing that allows you to collect anything into a package, allows you to build package. It's a part of official Python package, if you like, official Python interpreter, and it's of course well documented. You may check it. Cytonize, it's a function that you describe that you use for compiling your Cython code, including C++ or C code. You may include you may mix Cython code, PyX files, C++ files, H files, C files, everything what you want inside that. Beside that, Cytonize, it's a command that available from command line. But if you want, you may read it in official documentation. Now I would like to focus on the code, Python code. Okay, you write command cytonize, write extensions, and extensions. You may put it right here. It doesn't necessary to move outside, but I decided to move it in another place just for convenience. Extension, it's a part of distutils class from distutils in which you describe your extensions, your shared library. Name, it's has a Python import a semantic Python import path that describes you when you would like to put your shared library and which name it should has without extension, without suffix, like without .so, without .dll, without anything else. It just name to the binary file with path. I think like I would like to import from that module, and path to import you put here in name. Sources, it's a sources file to compile into binary extension. Just put everything that you want to combine together right here. As I said, it's a PyX, C++, and so on and so forth. It's regular path inside your operation system, like /directory1/directory2/_knn.pyx and something like that. And of course, additional arguments. Again, you may put that those arguments right here inside description of extension, or you may move it outside. Moving outside is convenient when you have the same extension arguments for different extensions, just to avoid duplicating of code. You describe language, C++. Of course, if you have one extension which is written in C++, another in C, this part will differ. But it's up to you how to describe it. And of course, you have to put this line to say Cython to compile to generate C++ code, because by default it generates C code, which is slightly differs. Compile directives, anything additional which would you like to say? Compile, Cython compile, and include directories. That it's H files, pass to H files. Libraries, dirs. It's a list of libraries that you would like to include here, meaning link to that, and path to that to those libraries, because your libraries may be placed in different directories. It doesn't necessarily part of your code. It might be system libraries, it might be third party libraries, and you should be able to define different paths. Extra link arguments, it's arguments of linker, extra compile arguments. By default, it compiles with O2 optimization level. If you want really fast code, you may put your own, redefine that argument by O3. Language standards, like in this case, it's a C++ 11. OpenMP, which means that we use OpenMP multiprocessing framework, which allows easily control multithreading in C++ code by using corresponding directives. FastMath, native, by the way, please pay attention that it's a compiled code, it's binary code, and you compile it, you optimize it for this specific architecture. Once you compile it for instance, for x86 architecture, it will work only for that, not for ARM, not for 8664. It's compiled. It's not portable. Once you moved your package in another computer with another operation system or a bit different version of that system, you cannot guarantee that it will work on that. You must recompile it before using. It's probably the biggest disadvantage of using binary extensions. And Architecture Native, it's from Gentoo book. Most of that speed optimization is from Gentoo book. If you want, you may check it, what it means. G0 means that you say compile to remove any debugging symbols. It's and S, you want to get a result optimized by size as small as possible. In case you need to undefine any macros, just put it here. In this case, we remove and debug macros. It's from NumPy, just because we don't need debug symbols from NumPy inside our code. And if you need to undefine or define anything, you may put it in extra arguments here. Yeah, as I said, you may write several include directories, libraries, directories, write in extra arguments. Compiler directives, you Cython provides you additional control over compiling, over building extension. For instance, you may define your own build extension class. In this case, Python 3, you may define your own output name. In this case, I faced with some strange behavior, strange for me, that produces weird output name in my machine, in Python 3 code, with redundant suffix that I don't need to have. And I decided to redefine output name by using by overriding this method, get extension file name. If you want, you may check it, you may check that class, you may check functions, methods that this class provides, and write control it as tune it as you want, as you need. And yeah, one more thing. Cython, in particular CythonEyes, creates C or C++ files. Depends on language which you use. As I mentioned earlier, from your PyX file after compilation, it's an intermediate file that Cython generates. Cython generates after CythonEyes generates C++ files, which uses which regular compilers in your system uses for compiling binary extension. Pattern is simple. It just replaces suffix from PyX to C++ or C. It depends on your on language. Result is a shared library. Again, it depends on system. It might be .so, .dll, which system you use. And because of that, it's important to put couple lines into your gitignore file, because Probably you don't need to have SO files into your GitHub or Git repository, as well as temporary C++ or C files. That's why I named PyX file in that manner, like underscore kn.pyx, just because it allows me easily write what to remove, what to skip, anything that starts from underscore and ends by C++ may be safely removed. In case if I didn't use that pattern, it's difficult to define how to remove how to exclude temporary files from Git repository, how to remove that. I don't know which nice solution is acceptable here, except using some pattern in names of PyX files. It's a pattern which I use. You may define your own, anything what you need. And of course, before testing, you need to build your extension, your own extension, and that just say setup py test. And it's one way. Another way, you may just build again your extension and run that testing framework which you use, like nose test, y test, unit test too, and so on and so forth. And it's up to you. But anyway, before running test, you have to build extension. Extension should be built first, and then you may do anything what you need. And that's all from my side.